where God is still speaking, and wherever you are in life's journey, you are welcome.
Come, make gods of us, who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt. We do not know what has become of him. Aaron said to them, take off the gold rings that are on your ears of your wives, your sons and your daughters, and bring them to me. So all the people took off the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it in a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord. They rose early the next day, offered burnt offerings, and brought sacrifices of well-being, and the people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to revel. So ends the first reading.
Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so, I
tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'm honored to be here this morning, not only because it's the day that we gather together in God's house, but it's the 15th anniversary of 9/11. Today is an especially sacred and holy day. And I love today's reading because we have a couple of Jesus' parables. He used everyday stories to help others see things in a new way. It helps us to see God in ordinary life, the minutiae. In my role as a hospice chaplain, I'm helping people to see God all around them, pointing out God at work, that God is not some far-off in the clouds deity, that God dwells in the midst of his people. Using parables was a way to say something without defenses going up. Now in the first part of our reading, it says, "Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus, and the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, 'This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them.'" Every single time I've ever read this passage, I've always identified with the sinners and the tax collectors in the story. Sinners, in the context of the Pharisees we're referring to, were people outside of the boundaries of what were considered clean. And we know that society has always outcast people for all kinds of reasons. In the name of religion, in the name of cleanliness, purity, in the name of morality, in the name of racism, in the name of sexism or classism, in the name of any type of disability or illness, in the name of "they're not from around here," in the name of "we've always done it that way before, we don't like change," in the name of "not in our family, not in our town," in the name of. You couldn't have certain professions and be considered clean, such as tax collectors, shepherds, camel drivers, sailors, tanners, gamblers with dice. So I've always put myself in that group with the sinners and tax collectors. I was there to hear Jesus, with the Pharisees off the side jeering. But somewhere in the middle of the night last week, my training as a chaplain kicked in. We would write verbatims, word for word, transcripts of our visits with patients and families, and we would line out the parts like a play, be assigned to different people. My instructors would never let me read my own part, but would have me read the part of a patient or a family member. It gave me a new perspective on a visit and a conversation. So I'm sitting there and I'm looking at the text and I'm wrestling with it, and there sat the role of the Pharisee and the scribe, which I've never identified with. So I thought, okay, let me see if I can get into the head of the Pharisee. Okay, I'm an upstanding fellow. I'm righteous. Most folks like me. I'm well respected in the temple. This Jesus of Nazareth has quite a number of people starting to follow him. He's got a lot of strange ideas. He's getting some things wrong. And I'm still trying to get into the Pharisee's head. And then I read that the Pharisee is grumbling because Jesus is eating with the sinners and tax collectors. Why does that upset him? Why does that matter? And then I think, well, these are people that the Pharisee would not eat with. I'll ponder on this. Well, who is it that I wouldn't eat with? I'd eat with anyone. No one was coming to mind. I'm a pretty open person. Do you have anyone that you wouldn't want to eat dinner with? I couldn't think of anybody. I like everybody. And I sat stewing on it, and I thought about it, but I remembered this X, and yeah,
he's a psychopath, I don't believe him. And then there was her, she was as bad as he ever was. You know, and there's a whole group of them. They turned their back on me, hung me out to dry. I ain't eating with them. There's that other girl, she's two-faced. Oh, two-faced as they come. Well, my halo tilted quite a bit as I realized I've got a lot more work to do. So I go back into my Pharisee mode, and I imagine all those people that I didn't want to eat with sitting over there having supper with Jesus. I didn't like that one bit. I started grumbling and mumbling, and I'm surprised I didn't wake my mother up in the next room. Jesus, you better know what kind of people you're eating with. I have to exercise a lot of demons over there to get through that meal. Better keep both eyes open. And then it hits me. I might have been out of my comfort zone in this new role, but I fit into that Pharisee mode pretty well without too much effort. I personally still have much work to do. On one hand, I'm a Pharisee. I'm still grumbling. And on the other hand, I'm thinking about this lost sheep and the lost coin and that all people are God's children. And then it hits me that sitting right in front of the Pharisees, right there, that Jesus is having divine communion with his children, the ones that were outcast. And what is it that Jesus says a lot? That the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of heaven is near. And there it was. It was sitting right there in front of the Pharisees, showing acceptance to all of God's children. Like our wonderful open communion that we do every Sunday, where everyone is invited. The Pharisees' heart is so hard, they can't see it. You know, Jesus is eating with the outcasts as a celebration, much like the ones in the reading that happened once the sheep and the coin were found. But the Pharisees and the scribes, they won't join the party. They're still mumbling and grumbling, unable to be happy for those that were lost and now found. And there's a story about a farmer. I've got a lot of farmer stories. God is going to grant him three wishes. And the farmer is so excited. And God tells him there's a catch. There's a catch. Whatever you ask for, I'm going to give your neighbor double. Well, the farmer's excited still. He's like, I don't care about all that. This is great. This sounds good. So the farmer makes his first wish, and he asks for 100 cattle. And whammo, he's got 100 cows. The farmer is extremely excited and unable to believe his good fortune. Things are really looking up for his family. But then he looks out across the field and sees those other cattle up on the hill, and he finds out, he asks, and that yes, his neighbor got 200 cows. Well, that's okay. My 100 cows is nothing to sneeze at. And the farmer is ready to make his second wish to God and ask for 100 acres of land, and whammo, just like that, he gets 100 acres of land. Plenty of room for his cows and family. He thinks, I'm a landowner now. I have truly arrived. Life is good. I will be well respected in the village now. But after a time, he finds out that his neighbor now has 200 acres of land. Well, everything he got was because of me. He didn't earn that. He certainly doesn't deserve it. And the farmer mumbles and he stews. He grumbles. Jealousy and anger harden his heart. And God asked about his third wish, and the farmer thought, I'll fix that neighbor of mine now. The farmer told God to strike him blind in one eye. And the story goes that God wept. At times we have a hard time being happy for God's mercy and benevolence when it's for someone else. Will we answer the call and celebrate that all are God's children, even those we don't want to eat dinner with at the table for whatever reason? Pray to remove the hardness from my heart so that I can come to the party and feel the joy. And as I reflect about the lost sheep and the lost coin, the Pharisees and the scribes and the tax collectors and the sinners, and I wonder, who is it that is really lost. Depending on your point of view, it could be any of them. And I think about the different ways that we can become lost. In our first reading today, it was the Israelites camped out at the bottom of Mount Sinai, making their golden calf. Moses had been up on that mountain for a very long time. Who knew if he was coming back down? The Bible describes the top of the mountain as looking as though it was consumed by flame. It does not go well for them when Moses comes back down. We can get lost following the wrong crowd. We get lost wandering aimlessly through life and suddenly have an awakening, wondering, where am I? How did I get here? We can feel lost without direction or out of step with the world around us. We get lost with bad priorities and addictions, not just the alcohol or drugs or gambling, but sometimes we can get wrapped up in our technologies, our smartphones, our Facebook. We felt lost after 9/11. It was a tragedy of such magnitude that it was like a page was turned in our lives. Everything was different afterwards. Life is funny. We grow the most when we feel lost, when the ground under us is shaking, or we've landed square on our backside. We grow through our challenges and our tragedies. When we're lost, we stop to think, we take time, we ponder, we reflect, just trying to work through things. Know that we are all a work in progress. None of us have arrived yet. Henry David Thoreau said, "Not until we are lost do we begin to understand ourselves." So what is the good news today? We have a God that is still speaking to us. We have a God who never gives up on us. We know that God will search tenaciously for us when we become lost. We know that God loves us unconditionally and is always with us. We know that we are all God's children, whether we find ourselves lost or found or somewhere in between.
Thank you. If you would please join me in the 9/11 remembrance. We remember the first time we heard the news. We recall the first time we saw those images. We remember the way our thoughts and prayers were with those families who lost loved ones. Our thoughts and prayers are with them again today.
Thank you.
your son, Jesus. Amen.
Oh, were touched today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service, and we hope to see you in person one day. We at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, are an open and affirming church that believes in equality for all. We have many ministries that reach out to the needs of those in our community, and there's always something here for everyone to be involved in. We believe that God is still speaking and that our ministry outreach can only continue its vital mission in bringing people to Christ through the support of people just like you. Please visit our website, uccftl.org, for more information about us, to submit a prayer request, or even donate to the church if you have been moved by the Spirit. You will help us in God's work in our ministry outreach. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and we hope to see you next week. May God's peace and love be with each and every one of you. And remember, God is still speaking.